Good afternoon, this delightful Friday afternoon in Milano, where my guest today is Lorenzo Capellati, who is a professor of economics at the Università Cattolica di Milano, and also recently become a senior researcher at the Luxembourg Institute LICER. So he's holding two appointments, two real jobs, and is very, very busy, but he has taken time to come and chat with me this afternoon about income inequality, and in particular about intergenerational inequality, which is a really important thing and something that really we've only started thinking about in the last 20 or 30 years. It seems like a fairly new topic. So, Lorenzo, thank you for joining me this afternoon.
Thanks, Dan. It's a pleasure, and thanks for having me very much.
We've had lots of measures of income inequality, okay? But the interesting question is to what extent greater income inequality at a point in time indicates anything about intergenerational inequality, intergenerational mobility. Are these things related or are they completely independent?
I think that from, let's say, a statistical point of view, they are independent because they have to do with different aspects of the income distribution. So, you know, if inequality is more about ranks in a point in time and how far are the low ranks from the high ranks, instead mobility has to do with the changes of ranks over time. So these are indeed different, let's say, parameters of the distribution, right? So there's no link in principle, which I think makes the overall thing interesting, because then, you know, it's a matter of looking up in the data and see how the two go together. And the evidence that we have, which is, one of the most famous pieces of evidence is the Great Gatsby curve, which was brought about by Canadian economist Miles Corak, which shows that across countries, high inequality goes hand in hand with low mobility, with lack of mobility. Okay, and this is true across country, but it's also true for regions within a country. For example, it's true across the U.S. states. Raj Chatti and co-authors made available statistics of mobility for U.S. states. And if you match those to statistics of inequality for U.S. states that you can find, you will find, again, the Great Gatsby curve within the United States, or other researchers have done this exercise in Italy, across provinces in Italy, and again, the curve comes out. So basically, while unrelated in principle, inequality goes hand in hand with lack of mobility, which, in a sense, is like saying, it's saying that basically there is an issue here of lack of incentives, essentially, because with wide income distributions, then there is no chance to climb the income ladder generation after generation, and this makes for a kind of a static society, not a fluid society. And there's also evidence that, that there is a third variable here, which is, let's say, economic prosperity, GDP growth, whatever, which also goes with lack of, goes with mobility. So where there is more mobility, there is more prosperity. Okay? So it seems that, more an equal society, but then with lack of mobility, tend also to suffer in terms of economic performance. So in a sense, there is individual to exert effort, stuff like that.
Let me ask you this then, okay? So what you're saying is if, as we now are in a rather severe, certainly rich worldwide recession, I think that's a fair statement. What you're saying is that that's going to both increase income inequality and reduce intergenerational mobility. Is that a fair conclusion?
Well, that's a possibility. That's a possibility in the sense that for the characteristics that the current big shock that is hitting us has, it seems that it is affecting both inequality, increasing it, and reducing mobility. So there are features of what's happening that are conducive to, maybe conducive to lower mobility. So yes, that's definitely a possibility. Yeah.
That's really depressing. Let me ask you then, is it correct to infer from what you're saying that policies that would reduce income inequality would also increase mobility, or are the policies really different to deal with each problem?
Well, certainly policies that are aimed at fostering mobility may, I mean, for any given level of inequality, may change the identity of the dynasties who are at the top or at the bottom. So it's not, rather than saying that they're going to reduce or increase inequality, is more a matter of changing who is going to, you know, experience more, suffer more from being on a low income rank or on a high income rank. You know, all policies that are targeting in towards making disadvantaged kids getting more schooling, okay, than they would counterfactually do, this may have an impact on the actual schooling level of these kids. And of course, schooling is one of the engines of intergenerational mobility. Therefore, in a sense, they are going to reduce the long run inequality in the long run, whatever that means, right? So it's not just inequality at a point in time that is going to be affected, but in a long run sense, dynasties will be more close to one another, so to speak. Yeah.
Let me ask you about a specific policy which has always intrigued me.
Yeah.
Thomas Piketty has proposed a wealth tax. In the U.S., for all intents and purposes, we've abolished inheritance taxes.
Yes.
You have to have an immense estate to pay inheritance taxes.
Yes.
What if we were to tax inheritances much more heavily in the U.S. and other rich countries? Would that make a big difference, or is it really fiddling at the margins? What do you think?
My feeling is that, policies that act on resources and on transfers of resources have, in a sense, always been there, always been in place in one form or the other, right? Because, you know, in the limit, also progressive taxation is a policy that wants to redistribute from one agent to the other, from the top to the bottom. But still, the situation is what we see nowadays for intergenerational mobility. And we know that, you know, in many countries, there's lack of mobility, or anyway, there's a gradient of countries. So perhaps there should be a little bit of a shift of the focus from resources to behavior and expectations, so to speak, because somehow, you know, even if this whole set of policies is in place, is not working. There is a part of it that is not working in promoting mobility. So even, let's say, with completely free education and completely free health provision, there are still blocks somewhere in society to the fluidity and to the mobility. And perhaps these blocks are very much inside the family and the cultural transmission that is going on, in the family, which is the most difficult part to intervene, perhaps, go inside the family and be invasive. I'm not suggesting that one should be invasive, but there are examples of program of consultation with parents, for example, with parents of particularly of young kids transmit knowledge about what are the most effective parenting styles, or knowledge about what are the key stages of human development and where, you know, actions have an effect. So I think that this kind of policies that you know, very much try to see what, to leverage on what occurs in inside an household, can be the more effective in promoting mobility.
So it's not just taxation, it's not just more easier access to education. What you're saying is the majority of the intergenerational inequality issue is with us, it's within our families. And how are we going to do that without tremendous intervention by governments into family life? I mean, is that going to really happen, do you think?
I mean, these interventions, like consultations, focus groups with the, these are examples, and there are evaluations of these kind of programs. For example, in Ireland, showing that they've been rather effective, but also other measures like trying to provide preschool for going back to resources, trying to provide preschool to everyone. There's evidence that preschool kids do better when adults than non preschool kids. So, these may be more, that they can be a possibility. Another thing is school quality, because, one thing is say school for everyone, but then there's a quality gradient in teaching and in schooling. So, for example, give incentives to teachers to go and teach in the private areas. This can be another idea, not to go in the nice downtown schools with all the kind of middle class kids where there is all this sort, the, let's say, good society, but provide monetary incentives to teachers to, go outside more the private areas. This is another possibility, for example.
These are all very difficult to do. I mean, I think I see what you're talking about and why these might work better than a lot of the things we do. But wow, it's not easy to get people to behave this way. It's not easy politically to get governments to do this kind of thing. I think that's the problem. Let me ask you one final question. I alluded earlier to the COVID thing. What do you think about how COVID will affect public and government interest in doing this kind of necessary intervention? I'm pretty depressed about this possibility. Am I missing something?
Right. I think that the current state will urge governments to move in these directions. There are reasons to believe that COVID may hamper mobility. Of course, mobility is by its own nature, it's a long-term phenomenon. Right? So it's difficult to think about effects of, let's say, 1 year, change or drastic change of environment. But, for example, take school closures. School closures means that children have to stay at home with the parents. So, again, the human capital of the parents bounces back, and the parent again become a key factor and a key ingredient of a key mediating factor of the impact of the shock on the learning behavior of the kids. And so again, there's a gradient and there's a possibility for reduced intergenerational mobility there, as the kids of the less educated are going to suffer more than the kids of the higher educated. This is one thing. Another thing is that the impact of the shock is heterogeneous along the wage distribution. Top jobs, maybe they can be run as smoothly or even better from home than from the office sometimes, and job losses in the top half of the wage distribution perhaps are not an issue. There are jobs that cannot be worked remotely, bottom end, and there are job losses there, and some transitory shock may translate into a permanent long-term unemployment. As we know, it happens sometimes, and so for governments. So what's the lessons for governments? First of all, to prioritize groups in need, like low, low-wage families of low-wage workers, family low-educated families in need of having support to support the learning activity of the children, and more in general to make, for example, the school environment, the learning environment, the less subject to a lockdown. As a longer run policy to really invest in school infrastructure, make school safer and you know, safer places, and also invest in digitalization, such as there is no digital device that prevents some from participating into the online learning process that is developing in these months.
Fascinating. I think the most interesting thing of all of this, let me just finish with this comment, is how thinking about COVID has informed almost everything we economists are doing these days. And I think we've made a lot of progress on it, but deep down, in terms of what the longer term effects are going to be, I don't think, maybe you disagree, that we've made a lot of progress in deciding and forecasting the longer term effects. Is that a fair conclusion? Or do you think we've got to pick
it up? I mean, I think we are in a kind of process of day-by-day learning of what these effects may be. We may speculate. We may speculate, and based on what we know, we can make some projection. For example, this thing about learning effectiveness and its heterogeneous impacts and possible consequences for intergenerational mobility, but of course we are still on the learning curve.
Okay. Anyway, look, it's a pleasure having you here this afternoon, Lorenz. I've had Lorenzo Capellari of Cattolica di Milano and also Leischer in Luxembourg with me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me. It was my pleasure.